9 years old was a very defining age for me, not because I was super adorable and had great pajamas, but because in the third grade, I learned about the human organ systems. I learned that we have lungs that take big gulps of air and that our bloodstream carries oxygen from the lungs to the rest of our bodies so that we can walk, talk, and do karate or whatever it is that I'm doing. And I didn't give too much thought to this lesson at the time, but later in the day, I was at recess, and my classmates and I were having a race from one end of the field to the other. When the race started, I took off running as fast as I could, because you know that when you're in third grade, being the fastest kid in class is like winning the Nobel Prize. So there I was running at lightning speed, and I noticed that I was breathing really heavy, and all of a sudden, something clicked. I had this huge light bulb moment, and I stopped in the middle of the race, and I was like, I'm breathing really heavy because I need more oxygen, and my blood is carrying that to my legs so that I can run really fast and win the race. Well, of course, I didn't win the race because I was just standing there thinking about all of these things, but this is a really important moment for me because I realized that there were all of these things going on around me and inside of me that I had never given any thought to before, but they were just waiting to be discovered. And that was the moment that I fell in love with science. That love of science eventually led me here to Stony Brook University, where I'm pursuing a PhD in molecular and cellular biology. When I started here at Stony Brook, I envisioned a grand plan for myself, which was to get my PhD, do a few years of postdoctoral training, and then get a job as a tenured professor at a university. And I believed that this would lead me to my ultimate goals of career success and happiness, and that I would be able to change the world. And it seemed like a pretty simple and straightforward plan to me, but during my second year of graduate school, I became familiar with the academic lifestyle, and I realized that that plan just wasn't going to work. I put down my pipettes and I said, I can't do this for the rest of my life. This isn't going to bring me the fulfillment that I'm looking for, and it's not going to let me change the world in the way that I want to change it. But I really struggled to admit this because I thought that it meant that I was a failure and that I didn't belong in science. And I reasoned that since I didn't want to go on to become a professor and run my own research lab, that I shouldn't even bother getting my PhD. So I almost quit. I almost gave up on that dream. And at this point, I reached a mid-PhD crisis, and I was waking up most days thinking, what am I doing with my life? Why am I here? And having that scientist identity taken away from me, I started trying to think of alternatives that I could do instead, like become a beekeeper, which I seriously considered for a while. But what ultimately kept me here was that passion for science that for me started in the third grade. I just wasn't ready to give up on that yet. So I continued on with my studies, but I still had all of these fears and insecurities circulating around in my mind. And eventually, I gathered up the courage to start talking about it with some of my classmates and doing research online. And I learned some interesting things. I learned that I wasn't the only one feeling this way, and that many of my classmates and graduate students across the country felt exactly the way that I did. We were all really passionate about our field of study, but we knew that that academic track wasn't for us, and we weren't sure what to do with these two conflicting ideas. But I was comforted to know that I wasn't the only one thinking and feeling this way. I also learned that the desire for PhDs to leave academia is really only half of the issue. It turns out that universities award 7 times more PhDs than the number of available faculty positions. And this was a fact that I had never heard while I was applying for school or the entire time that I've been here. But the result is that students spend years getting their PhDs and postdoctoral training, and then they can't find the faculty jobs that these degrees were originally geared for. So where does that leave me and all of these other students who either want to leave academia or want to stay but just can't find the job? Well, what I slowly realized is there's an entire world of opportunity outside of the academic world. And it's actually so large that it's more like a universe. And I had never really heard much about it before, and I was really fascinated, so I tried to read as much as I could. I read one story, for example, about a physics PhD who now works at the Metropolitan Museum of Art, helping to chemically analyze the artwork. And another story about a linguistics PhD who is now the social media specialist at Rosetta Stone. So in reading all of these really cool stories, I realized that the career opportunities for PhDs in this non-academic universe is really limitless. And that was totally exciting to me, and it led me to another epiphany, which is that a PhD isn't a one-way ticket to academia, but it's really more like a passport that can take you anywhere you want to go. You just have to choose your destination and pack your bags accordingly. So once I realized this, I felt really revitalized, and I had regained the motivation to pursue my studies again with some energy, because I knew that there was a path for me, and I just had to figure out what it was. Around this time, I started having lunch with a classmate and friend of mine. Like me, Jennifer knew that the academic track wasn't for her, but we shared a common interest in trying to figure out exactly what our paths might be. So over our lunches, we would talk about our interests and passions and goals that we had for ourselves. And then we each took a self-assessment test, which is a lot like a personality test that you would find in a magazine. But the one that we took was geared for scientists. And it had us rank our daily activities on a scale of 0 to 5. And when I took the assessment and I got the results back, I wasn't too surprised to find that I had given zeros to things like grant writing and budget management, which are really integral parts of the academic lifestyle. So I was reassured that that life really isn't for me. But I was really surprised to see that I had given fives to things like talking to the public about science or getting up on stage and giving a presentation to 100 people, because I have a hard time just getting on the phone and ordering a pizza. So when I told Jen about this, she said, "You know, Nadia, you are a really good public speaker." And all of a sudden I was like, "Yeah, I am." And then when Jen took the assessment, she realized that she had really strong writing skills and that she really liked being in the middle of scientific discoveries. And I said, "You know, Jen, you really like going to conferences and exchanging ideas." And she was like, "Yeah, I do." So what I think we both realized is that sometimes you need an outsider's perspective to help you realize things about yourself. Our next step was to try to figure out careers that matched with these skills and interests we had just identified. Jen found her passion in scientific journal editing, and I found mine in science communications and public outreach. Once we had identified our dream jobs, we knew that we had to do a little bit of preparation work in order to get ourselves there and make ourselves really good candidates. So we started getting outside of the lab so we could get experience and build up our skills and test those interests that we had identified. So we started doing things like freelance writing and taking communications classes and judging science fairs and all really, really fun things. And after all of these efforts, we both reached a place where we could identify our career aspirations and set goals for ourselves to actually achieve them. Reaching this point was really pivotal because I experienced a huge boost in self-confidence, and now I'm waking up every day really excited to come to campus and do all the things that I'm doing because I know that I'm on the right path and I'm going somewhere that I actually want to go, and I'm really becoming the person that I want to be, and that's really powerful. So when I looked back at this progress that Jen and I made over the year, I realized that we had stumbled upon something very valuable. Because the current structure of PhD training doesn't really dedicate time or resources to career development or preparation of any kind, academic or otherwise. And yet there are so many students who really need and want this, and we know how important it is to prepare for a postgraduate career prior to graduation. So when I thought about this, I realized that I had the ability to change this, that I could do something about this. So I designed a career development program for graduate students based on the principles of peer support and incremental progress. I named it the PhD Career Ladder Program because a ladder facilitates small steps and supports you as you climb to the top. The program has two main objectives, which are to help students identify their career goals and help them prepare for those goals, So choosing your destination and packing your bags to get there. These objectives are separated into 9 steps, and each of the steps builds upon the previous one so that students who participate in the program are actively progressing in their career development. They're actually getting somewhere. Jen and I are currently piloting the program with a small group of graduate students from our department. We meet once a month to accomplish one step of the program at a time. And the first few steps are about self-assessment. So taking the test and figuring out your skills, interests, and values, and then finding careers that match with those characteristics. Now, not every student will obviously find their perfect match right away, but part of the process is figuring out what you don't want to do as much as what you do want to do. So to help this along, we do informational interviews, which just means reaching out to a professional in the field of interest and asking them what their daily activities are, what the challenges of their job are, what they really like about it, maybe even what the salary is. And that gives students an insider's perspective and helps them decide if that would be a good fit for them. The interesting thing is that in our pilot group, we're all from the same department. We all study cell biology, but we had such a huge range of career interests. For example, sales and marketing, K-12 teaching, biotechnology, academia, science writing, and we got to learn about all of these careers together. Once everyone had chosen a career of interest that they felt that they could follow through with, we went on to the preparation stage. So we made a list of skills which are required by our career of interest, and then we thought about ways that we could enhance those skills. So again, getting out of the laboratory setting and getting experience and building up your skills. I have to say that this was probably the hardest part of the program because graduate students tend to get tunnel vision and they're just focused on their thesis, graduating and getting out of there. But when they finally do that, then they're looking around like, okay, now what? So we had to convince our classmates to put down their research for a little bit and get outside of the lab. And we were able to do this luckily. We had one student who landed an internship and another group of students who formed a newsletter and are now writing about the research going on campus. The final steps of the program teach students how to translate those skills and experiences that they've just obtained on paper and in person so that when that dream career comes around, they can actually achieve it. The goal is that by the end of the program, students have a clear path in front of them, and hopefully they experience that same boost in self-confidence that I did. Our pilot program is almost complete, and we're going to rerun it again in 2015 with a new group of students. Luckily, the director of our graduate program recognizes the value of the latter program and is integrating it into the PhD training, which I think is really awesome, and I'm so proud, and I can't wait to see how it benefits students in the future. So when we asked the pilot group for feedback and what they liked about the program, one of the biggest responses was just having a time and place to talk about and think about career development. And students also really appreciated the group sharing model. So coming together to exchange information and ideas and get feedback and get advice. And we realized that we all had small pieces of information, but then when we came together to combine them, it really formed something significant. And we were able to learn so much more than we could if we were going through the process on our own. Now, I may be biased because I started the program, but I think one of the greatest advantages is its simplicity, and that it requires very little for startup. We really only needed a meeting space, the ambition to start the program, and a dedication to each other and to ourselves. And I think that makes the latter program a simple, bottom-up approach to career development that any graduate student at any university can attain. So if you're in the audience or you're listening and you can identify with my story, I encourage you to grab a group of friends and go through the career development process together. And I really encourage you to do that because I think you'll be surprised by the results. And if you want to follow the model that we used, you can find it online. And maybe you're in the audience or you're listening and you're not a graduate student. Maybe you're feeling a little bit uncertain about yourself or your future. Well, I hope that you can still be inspired by the latter program, either directly or indirectly. And this is my advice to you. First, seek support. Find a friend or family member, someone that you admire, and ask them to support you as you go on this journey, because as I mentioned, sometimes you need an outsider to help you realize who you are. And second, take the time to going on the journey. Really think about who you are, what you want out of life. Think about passions that you may have forgotten about, or take the time to discover new ones. And third, be ambitious, take risks, do things that you never thought you could do, like give a TED Talk or jump out of an airplane. And I guarantee that when you get to the edge of your comfort zone, you'll realize who you are. And finally, be brave. Don't give up, don't quit. You may not be able to see that path that's there in front of you, but just know that it's there and that you can get to it. Thank you.